My guest on the other side of the screen is Pao Fernández Garrido, and she is part of the World Fish Migration Foundation. She is in Spain, and one of the reasons to talk to her is that New England and the Canadian Maritimes have more dams because it's an older part of the country vis-a-vis European settlement. Well, Europe is even older, so she has an interesting perspective. Mucho gusto, Pao.
Gracias, thank you.
Now, there is this trend in North America to removing dams because people have done economic analysis and tried to weigh the value of the fish versus the value of the electricity and all these complex bits of research. What's going on in Europe?
Well, we found out this past 2 years and a half of research that in Europe, we are removing dams too. Not all the countries, but the most active ones are France, Sweden, Finland, Spain, and UK, especially Wales and England. And we are removing a lot too. Our inventories, the ones that we have been able to collect, the numbers goes up to over 5,000 barriers. So it's a lot. Nobody's really talking about this, but it's a lot.
5,000 have been removed.
Yes. So if you see the inventories, France has removed over 2,300. But I have to say something important. A note that France, which is number one, and Sweden number two. France is 2,300, and Sweden is 1,600. They do not distinguish between man removed and collapse, naturally collapse. They don't make a distinction. They do in Wales, England, and Spain, and Finland, they do. Finland has removed over 500, and they do make a distinction. So it really depends on the country.
Okay, so some fall down, and some are removed on purpose, and that raises the question in my mind, and I'm new to this, but that raises the question, why? I always thought that even little dams that turned a wheel and ground the grain and maybe even created a little pond, the town swimming hole. What is the rationale behind removing dams? Because they were key to the Industrial Revolution for 100 years.
Yeah, well, you have to think something important. It depends, that is sometimes it's a big difference between countries, okay? There is huge difference between countries here in Europe. So you have to take into account that. For example, just think that in some countries like Spain or Portugal, our rivers are completely public, okay? That doesn't happen in Sweden or in UK where rivers are public, or French, which France is half and half. So the situation changes a lot in the river property, in the legislation of each country, but in general, I can tell you that the main driver for these removals is because of the Water Framework Directive. Water Framework Directive is a huge, very powerful law on European level that looks after keeping rivers and water clean. And this started in 2000, in year 2000. And the first analysis after 15 years, you know, going and analyzing and studying the rivers, is that European rivers, not even half of European rivers, reach a good, what we call good water status. They fail. So one of the reasons now at this point is not water pollution anymore, because water pollution has been improved a lot the past 30 years, 20 years. So now one of the main reasons is river fragmentation, so dams, right? Weirs and dams. So one of the main drivers for many countries is removing dams and weirs to try to reach the goals of the Water Framework Directive, our law.
Okay, but remember, I'm new to this. So for me, in my mind, a dam blocks up the river and helps generate power. It's supposedly clean power, you know, hydroelectric power is supposedly clean. Why are the dams responsible for any pollution in the river?
Okay, so that's a big mistake. And this is something actually we explained very well in our first documentary we made a year ago, which is called Love Flows, we explain it there very well. People confuses the word clean or green to renewable. That's very different. Those are very different terminology, okay? So renewable is something, but clean or green means that it doesn't have any negative impact, but that's not true. Dams have huge impacts to river ecosystems and in general all ecosystems. And let me explain you in a very simple way, okay? So you understand. Imagine that I put you a block in your veins. It's just the same way because rivers are the veins of the whole ecosystem, right? So does it have the same impact if I put you just one little block, one little vein of your little finger? Or is it just the same if I put you many blocks all over your body and even blocks in your artery, the main channel? It's not the same. This is the same.
Okay, exactly. So, are there other environmental hazards with dams?
Yeah, there are many more. So as you said, in the moment you put a barrier and the water stops from running, as you said, the temperature changes, which is crucial for many fish or fauna because they don't have coats, right? They feel the temperature, and with the temperature, they know when they have to migrate, when they don't have to migrate. The oxygen changes, the water is not moving anymore, so the oxygen changes and the quality of water. So usually the water quality actually not improves. What's the opposite word? It goes worse, it gets worse, the quality. And actually that's another driver in France. In France, water quality is another driver to remove dams. Also, when you block the dam and the sediments get blocked, that's bad because you need the sediments to go down so you don't have erosion. You start having erosion because the water goes over the dam and now the energy of the water goes only to erode. The energy is not used also to transport as a backpack. It's not used to transport the sediment. It has nothing to transport anymore. So now it erodes. You know, all the energy is used to erode. So you have erosion problems. The nutrients, the river transport nutrients, just like in our veins. If you block those nutrients, they won't go to the rest of the river and to the deltas. Then you have deltas shrinking. Deltas start to shrink, to disappear. Also, you have problems with aquifer recharge because you are changing the water table, you know? So it's not only about migratory fish, which is pretty obvious, even though many people don't know that some fish needs to move around, you know, and go to certain places to reproduce. And actually, these barriers are officially, and this is in Spain, it's in our Ministry of Environment website. One of the main causes, for example, of the extinction of sturgeon, Spain doesn't have a sturgeon anymore, and it's because of dams. Sturgeon was not able to go back to the rivers to reproduce, and they just were kept in the sea, and they were not able to go back. And our sturgeon is extinct, salmon is about to extinct here, eel is about to extinct. We have less than 4% of the population. So, but it's not only about fish, okay? It's much more.
Well, and then just to stay with the fish for a bit, then there are all the other types of fish and living things like whales that we have on the east coast of North America that depend on those fish that go up and down the river. So it's all a chain reaction, right?
Exactly. And actually, what you tell me, there is a magnificent my favorite dam removal case, it's in Maine. And it talks exactly about that. In 1999, it was removed. The first barrier in Maine, if I recall correctly, that it was the government did not re-license.
They didn't renew a license, yes.
Exactly. It was the name of the Edward Dam. I think, yes. It was Edward Dams. Yeah, in the Kennebec River, and that was in 1999. Then, so they removed the first dam to be removed that was not re-licensed, the permit, and after that in 2007 another dam was removed upstream. What happened after that? It was amazing. So this dam was put there in place in around 1865, okay? And fisheries were gone. So they had shad fisheries, they had sturgeon fisheries, and a few decades later, it was gone. after the removal of those dams, it's just amazing because shad, there was, they estimated that there were only around 70,000 shad on the feet of the dam, you know, the first barrier. And after that, 20 years later, the recovery, it's more than 5 million shad. What is this means? Oh, they have recovered shad population and fisheries, of course, and fisheries has, commercial fisheries has reopened. So business are flourishing, you know, flourishing around the river. But coastal fishermen, that's the most impacting thing. Coastal fishermen are starting to detect, do you say rebounding? Rebounding of haddock, of what is the other one? Haddock and cod, because shad is bait of this fish.
Okay,
so it goes to the ocean. The positive thing goes to the ocean because there's more bait, because there's more shad.
I've seen some research in the Canadian Maritimes and the New England states that say, you know, that's old thinking, that the power generated by some of these old dams is minuscule compared to what you can get out of maybe a windmill or a solar panel, and minuscule compared to the value of the fish. So talk about that. Have you seen that in Europe too?
Yes, yes. And actually, this is exactly the example I wanted to give you. The biggest dam being removed in Europe in this very moment, they started it in May of last year, 2019, and they are about to finish now. It's a dam in the Saloon River in Normandy, France, and it's 36 meters high. I'm sorry because I don't know of foot.
How many meters?
36 meters. That's
okay,
a lot.
So that's 100 feet or something.
I don't know. Okay, so that's the tallest. It's not as tall as the dams being removed in Washington State, you know, in the Olympic Park, but it's pretty big. And people were very worried about the hydropower was generating, but the power generating by that 36 meter high dam is going to be completely covered, generated by three windmills.
Three windmills.
So what I'm trying to say is that sometimes a dam, huge, that it's generating a huge impact, and actually in that river, salmon got extinct because of the dam, okay? There's no salmon anymore. Can be replaced sometimes by windmill, solar power, and other options.
But as for right now, what did I forget to ask you, because I'm not an engineer or a fish expert, what did I forget to ask you that you'd like to add?
I would like to say something, might be a little long, but when people here in Europe tell me, Pao, you remove dams? My God, but dams are good. And you, if you remove the dam, you're going to waste the water to the sea, Pao. You're going to be wasting the water. And that's so bad. And then people don't know about the impacts of dams, right? And I always tell them, wait a minute. How many dams do we have in Europe? Alan, nobody knew in Europe until 2 years ago that we discovered in our research in a project called Amber, nobody knew in Europe how many barriers we had in Europe. We only knew the big numbers, 7,000 big dams in Europe. Okay, fine, that's the tip of the iceberg. Now, after a 4-year project, totally covered by European Union, totally funded, after 4 years, we have discovered that at least we estimate we have 1.2 million, because we collected all the inventories available, existing.
Oh, wait a minute, let me make sure I got this. 1.2 million dams in Europe?
Yeah, wait. There's so much to talk about. People didn't know this number, Alan. Nobody, not even governments, okay? So we got this wonderful, fantastic project called Amber, with 20 organizations, not only us. We have been 4 years researching. And we have collected the available existing inventories in 33 countries. So we did this study for continental Europe, not only for European Union, okay? And when I say existing inventories, means that not all the countries have all the various inventories of the rivers. France or Sweden or England and Wales, they have fantastic inventories. And for example, France knows that they have 95,000, only France has 95,000 barriers, out of which 70,000 are weirs and dams. But other countries, like Italy, they don't know all the barriers, or Portugal, or Greece, right? And others have good inventories, like Spain, but I have estimated that we are missing like half of the data. So we don't have only 20,000. So in general, we collected 650,000 barriers, 650,000. But knowing that the number is very incomplete, so we estimated we have 1.2 million barriers in Europe. So I said to people, hey, we're not telling we are going to remove all the dams of the world. Well, I'm telling you that we have the most fragmented rivers in the world, and we need to just have the ones that we really use and locate them in the places that harms the less, the damage the less. Because as I told you in the beginning, is it the same thing that if I put you a stopper, a block in your artery, than in your hand? It's not, you, it doesn't have the same impact in your system. It's just the same in a river system. So it's very important. We need dams, but we need to be very responsible on how we use them.